It's sad. It's a sad reality that we live in, and I think New York State can take a smart approach to this and say, hey, our programs, they suck, because clearly they're not working if we have 34% of Americans with $0 in a savings account. I'm going to be very vocal about this today, and I'm going to continue to be vocal about this because this is something that really affects me, and I want this to change. Welcome to another episode of Dollars and Degrees, a show where we have conversations with students and professionals about personal finance, career development in the field of business, and the college student experience. I'm your host, Christopher Coyle, a freshman majoring in finance at Delphi University, right here in the beautiful foothills of Western New York. Thank you for being with us today. I know it has been quite some time since I've been back on the airwaves and out recording some more podcasts, but today we are back at it for 2024. This will be the first episode of 2024, and I am excited to get started today. We've got an important discussion to talk about, and I want to talk about, you know, the epidemic of financial illiteracy here in America. And I want to talk about specifically New York State and the financial literacy education improvements that I feel can be made to significantly improve the program that we have established here today in New York State. But before I dive more into New York State specific issues, I just wanted to give you guys some statistics to kind of chew on for the United States as a whole. So 69% of households today have less than $1,000 in emergency savings. Additionally, 34% of all Americans as individuals have $0 in savings. So that's roughly about 100 million people in this entire country have $0 in a savings account in their name. That's just scary. That is extremely scary stuff. And then additionally, 66% of millennials have zero retirement savings. So, you know, now as millennials are entering their 30s into their 40s almost here, you know, they have $0 saved and put towards their retirement savings when they will be retiring within the next 25, 30 years. So that's another scary statistic. Additionally, 72% of households do not have a written financial plan. Now, I don't necessarily have too many issues with that, because like a written financial plan, like some people might be able to do it in different formats than, you know, specifically writing it out. But 28% of American households have a proper financial plan. So I guess they're wording it as a proper financial plan. So some people are doing it different ways, but I think everybody could benefit from a written financial plan, maybe write it out on paper at the beginning of every month. Or I think in this day and age with these new technology improvements, I think people can do it in a digital format as well. And I don't know if this statistic's counting that or not, just the way it was worded. So maybe more people are doing it than there are. But I think the tough thing is with most plans and with financial plans and budgeting, it's just sticking to the plan and being able to be diligent and starting good habits and continuing to do your budgeting on a monthly basis and not falling behind and not, you know, ceasing to continue the process. But you know, here is a little bit of optimism for those who plan to continue doing their budgeting. It says 83% of people that set financial goals feel better about their finances after just 1 year. So that's a great statistic. Talks about the positive mental connection and the positive emotional connection and the stress reduction from being smart and diligent about one's personal financial plans. So let's just, you know, continue on these thoughts. The scariest statistic for me personally is 34% of Americans having $0 in their name in a savings account is just scary. That's scary stuff right there. Granted, you know, they might have some money left in a checking account, for example, but just set aside, you know, to have nothing set aside in any circumstance, to have nothing at all in a savings account it's tough to imagine, quite frankly. But let's talk about the core of the issue in my eyes, and that is the financial literacy programs that are in the schools today, and most importantly, high school, because high school is the last step before a child becomes an adult, before a child, you know, a kid becomes a college student. You know, you go on to the workforce, you go into the military. You know, this is a big, you know, stepping stone. The end of high school is a big stepping stone into one's adulthood and to one's ultimate, you know, personal financial freedom. They have all freedom of their choice. You know, you have your own freedom of choice as to what you want to do. You know, granted, oftentimes while students are in college, you know, the parents are still looking out for them. And even when you're in the workforce right out of high school, oftentimes parents are still looking out for you and helping you out in a very significant level. But still, for some students, you know, they're jumping out of high school and they're they're pretty much fending for themselves, per se. So when it comes to teaching kids personal finance, I want to talk about this article I found from the Rockland Westchester Journal News. And it says, taxes, savings, credit scores, how do New York schools stack up in personal finance education? So when it comes to teaching kids personal finance, New York State scores a B. And these grades are coming from the Center for Financial Literacy at Champlain College in Burlington, Vermont. 20 other states shared also got a B, which they earned because they require some amount of personal finance education. However, they fall short of a semester-long standalone course in personal finance, which would earn the state an A. Now, the director for this Center for Financial Literacy said, "Not a day will go by after a student graduates high school that they don't think about money." And that is certainly correct. New York State specifically requires students get about 15 hours of personal finance instruction as part of a 12th grade course in economics, he said. So, once again, I don't think this is enough. I personally just went through this supposedly 15-hour section of personal finance instruction as part of my 12th grade course in economics. And I can say, as someone who just recently finished this, it was horrible. I mean, I'm being completely honest. It was horrible. Like, it was just a pretty much last-ditch effort to kind of fulfill some basic requirements. And this is not a knack at my school specifically by any means. But, I mean, the instruction we received was a little more than, this is what a loan looks like, and this is how loans can be financed by either a fixed rate or a variable rate. In terms of interest, here is a credit card. You know, this is how you can improve your credit score. And then we kind of loosely explained that. And then we looked at picking out some average salaries for a variety of different positions post high school graduation. And then everybody did a presentation on what they wanted their job to be and what their salary would look like, you know, following graduation from whatever degree programs they needed to complete. So surprisingly, out of the 25 people in our class, it looked like almost everybody in the class is going to be confidently walking into a job paying $100,000 a year, six figures. So I find that very hard to believe. So I don't know if that was very successful in creating a very realistic approach to that exercise. However, that's about all we got, to be honest with you. I can't think of much more that we did when it comes to the personal finance instruction in my class, at least. But just to begin on this issue, I think we need to start the core of the issue. I think we need to start implementing in New York State specifically. We need to have a standalone semester-long course, because let's face the facts, personal finance is going to affect every single person the minute they leave their high school. As soon as they graduate, they're going to have a plethora of different issues and problems to solve, and they're going to have to navigate, you know, budgeting, paying for school, paying for their, you know, the student loans that come along with that, paying for different food, paying for their insurance, paying for their housing, paying for their car, paying for their car insurance. I mean, there's just so many costs of life that in personal finance, and then eventually, you know, setting yourself up for retirement down the road is a whole nother ball of wax. But, you know, there's so many different things that I think need to be taught in a standalone course. And I think, just to be frank, this course that the New York State is requiring right now is terrible. I mean, it did nothing for me. For me personally, and I have been doing different research into personal finance and kind of studying it and reading books and kind of taking up my own interest in the topic. But for someone who hadn't done that, they're pretty much screwed. To be completely honest with you, they're screwed. With the program that New York State has out there today, these students are at an extreme disadvantage, because this is providing absolutely nothing for them. I mean, all we talked about truthfully is a couple of different options for how to finance, you know, a home and a car. We talked about how to increase a credit card, you know, a credit score by getting a credit card or opening multiple lines of credit, etc. And then we also talked about starting salaries for different jobs. And we looked at a little bit of a couple examples with financing for things and paying for things and how to budget out your expenses. But other than that, we did nothing. And if that's all that New York State's going to do, New York State is really just hurting kids. They're hurting kids and they're hurting the next generation. And this next generation is going to just continue to fall into the footsteps and follow the path that their previous generations have done. And that previous generation, these previous generations are the ones that, you know, 34% of Americans out there right now have $0 in their savings account, right? I mean, it's just, it's sad. It's a sad reality that we live in. And I think New York State can take a smart approach to this and say, hey, our programs, they suck, because clearly they're not working if we have 34% of Americans with $0 in a savings account, and if we have 69% of households with less than $1,000 in emergency savings. Clearly we're failing them right now. And we need to look and reevaluate, you know, what we're offering right now and how can we do a better job of teaching financial literacy to students in high schools before they graduate and before they move on into wherever life's path may lead them. So let me take a quick break right now, and then I will continue to elaborate on my thoughts for how to improve the program, what needs to be talked about in these programs right after that. So I want to continue on the article that I had read from at the beginning of this podcast. And here are some statistics from a survey of about 1,000 adults from the National Endowment for Financial Education. And here's what these adults had to say about their states in terms of requiring a financial education course. And 88% of respondents to this survey, 88% of these adults said that they want their states to require a semester or year-long financial education course in high school. Even more telling, 80% wished they were required to take one while they were in school. That's just 8 out of 10 of these adults said, I wish I had a financial literacy and financial education course in high school, and I wish it was better. And that's what I'm hearing. And I can completely agree with that statement. Additionally, one of the flaws with New York State's program specifically, because that's what I'm really diving into here today, that I want to point out, is it was a 12th grade course in economics. And for me specifically, it was taught in, I believe, May and June of the school year. So let's just think about that. 12th graders being taught anything in May to June of their, I mean, this is their senior year. They are about to graduate. They have been counting down the days since probably January 1. Since January 1st, these students are counting down the days. Probably since the first day of school in September, some of them have been counting down the days until they graduate from high school and get out of this place. So why would something of such value and such importance be decided? Why has it been decided to be taught in 12th grade? And I know schools might be different from where I came from. They might have taught it in the beginning of the 12th grade school year. It might have been taught kind of sporadically throughout the year. But in general, why is it being taught at all? Why should it ever be an option to be taught at the end of the school year? Quite frankly, these students are just not going to be picking up any of the information, whether it be good, bad, or ugly. The information being presented in front of these students in the last 2 months of their senior year of high school, absolutely none of that is being digested. Absolutely none of that is being remembered. And these students are probably just checked out. So once again, yeah, New York has a program in place. Yeah, New York, you know, requires this 15 hours of financial literacy education. But New York has this 15 hours of financial literacy education being taught in the last 2 months of the school year when you have 12th graders who have absolutely no thoughts when it comes to, you know, am I going to really focus on my classes the last couple months of the school year? I mean, senioritis is raging at full force by the time May and June come along for in terms of graduation year. So one of the things that I think needs to be done and implemented is possibly requiring this course as a junior year course, or maybe requiring that it be taught in the first semester and not the second semester of senior year. Additionally, one of the directors from this Center for Financial Literacy, talked about how to make this a priority and how to have these states fit in a semester-long course. So he said one of the ways could be requiring personal finance in place of an elective that was already established. Additionally, they could add it as a requirement without taking any other course away. Or they could allow it to count towards more than one requirement for graduation. For example, allow the course to count as a math, social science, fine art, or foreign language credit. However, if not mandated, personal finance education, you know, very strong personal finance education in schools across New York State tends to be required in richer and whiter schools, which unfortunately is not surprising. And he said this director said that the best way to create equity, you know, throughout statewide schools, is to enact a bill and enact into law a requirement for a standalone course in personal finance education in New York State. And so this is something that I have a strong passion for. I have lived in New York State my entire life. I've gone through the public high school education system in New York State. I have seen this firsthand. I have been around many students from New York State. I go to college in New York State. In the next few months here and with this podcast, I think I'm going to shift one of the main goals of this podcast moving forward to be financial literacy and petitioning to the lawmakers of New York State to require and implement a semester-long financial literacy and education training program. This podcast is going to be just the start of that. This podcast is not going to be the end of that. I'm going to be very vocal about this today, and I'm going to continue to be vocal about this because this is something that really affects me, and I want this to change. And I think this is one of the benefits of living in a state like New York and living in a country like the United States is that we as citizens have this opportunity to be vocal about this issue. And so I'm begging my listeners and encouraging my listeners, please feel free to reach out to my email at ChristopherCoyle05@gmail.com. That is ChristopherCoyle05@gmail.com. Because I want to hear from more listeners who are, you know, similarly passionate about an issue such as this, and specifically from New York State, because I would really like to petition to some of the lawmakers, state senators, assemblymen here in New York State to see if we can get a bill brought to our state legislature to fix this issue, because ultimately I think we're going to continue to have more and more generations hurt by the current system we have in place, and we're not going to be able to see any results in terms of adults and their savings accounts until we fix the core of the issue in my eyes, which is the financial literacy education opportunities for students across the state and across the nation. But I think New York State is just one step in trying to get a financial literacy program enacted and trying to help fix the problems across our entire nation. So once again, please reach out to me if you feel similarly about this topic and this issue. I would greatly appreciate to hear from you and hear your thoughts on the issue as well, because I think there are multiple ways that we can go about fixing this. I think maybe implementing a junior level course, at minimum requiring the course, and then additionally, it needs to be more than 15 hours, you know, for one senior year. I think we need to look into possibly doing it at the beginning of senior year and not the end. Certainly, the course should not be taught at the end of one's senior year while in high school, because that's just ineffective. And anybody from the outside, if you ask any high school teacher, if you ask any high school student, they will tell you the same thing. Seniors have checked out by the time the last 2 months of school roll around, and anything that is being taught at that point of the school year is just, it's just not being understood. It's not being comprehended. So yeah, I hope that we can have some more of our listeners kind of reach out to me and continue to fight for this issue. I think personal finance needs to be a priority for students across New York State and for high school students specifically. We need to have them being taught the financial literacy education. We need to have them learning the basics. We need to have them learning budgeting. We need to have them learn how to make smart financial plans. We need to have them learn how to start their own savings account, start their own checking account, open up their first credit card, or maybe just stick with a debit card for now and pay with cash. and we need to teach students the dangers of credit card debt and consumer spending crisis that we have in the United States. We need to also teach students about student loans, the dangers of going to college for a degree program, you know, with requirements for, you know, this expensive degree, and then you get out of college and you're faced with a little bit of a struggle to find a job with low job placement. And in addition to that, you might have low salary for the job that you're looking for, and that's going to also hinder your ability to pay back these student loans. Additionally, you know, have students look into insurance, the costs of insurance, the costs of car insurance, the costs of, you know, healthcare. I mean, all these things Americans face on a daily basis. And I think if we can go to schools and high schools and have students, you know, at least have satisfactory understanding of these basic concepts and skills, I think ultimately the percentages will go down for in terms of a lack of financial literacy across the United States. And I think more and more future generations will be more successful within their own personal finances. So once again, I thank you all for joining us today and listening to this podcast. I greatly appreciate any support that I can get. Once again, please email me at ChristopherCoyle05@gmail.com, or you can message me at the Instagram page, which is $_and_degrees on Instagram. I always check my messages there as well. And please be sure to follow us on Instagram as well. I'll be posting about different things in the future that are not necessarily about new episodes, but, you know, maybe posting about new articles that I found online that could be of great support and great benefit to your personal financial goals and your college goals as well, for those of you who are interested in majoring in something in the business field that are still prospective students for the college experience. So thanks again for tuning into this episode. I hope to continue doing bi-weekly episodes moving forward from here on out. I'm going to get some great guests lined up for you guys the next few days here, and I will see you again next time on Dollars and Degrees. Take care.